There are nations already classified as advanced nations. There are some classified as developing nations. And they have continued to, you know, remain in that category. There are nations classified as third world. Why must there be third world countries? Why must it be that these countries that are even third world or developing are where the raw materials are coming in to develop the so-called advanced? So you are taking from the one that does not have to give more to those that already have. China today and America are the worst contributors to climate change. They pollute the environment more. But they want us, the third world nations, to have to keep forests that we absorb this. Why? They continue to pollute. They continue to flare gas. They continue to destroy the environment. We should keep our forest. We should not touch it. So we continue to become from slavery to outright colonization of our territories. Now they are doing it neo-colonial. They are continuing. So we continue to see us as their raw material, as their market that should buy their finished product. We continue to be poor while they continue to be rich. It should not be so. So this category, this categorization must stop, both within the nations, because in between the country, within the nations, inequality exists. There are some billionaires, like in Nigeria, where I come from, Dangote is the richest man in Africa. Yet Nigeria is the poorest, one of the poorest nations in the world. So there is inequality in between the country and between countries. All these ones must stop. Many people were very successful farmers and fishermen before oil was discovered in commercial quantity in 1958. But after about 30 years of oil exploitation and nothing, we didn't see nothing, not in terms of development, in terms of employment, in terms of amenity, nothing. Instead, the people were becoming poorer because the pollution from the oil production was destroying the fishing business of our people. The land was no longer productive, the soil was going. The flaring of gas 24 hours in very close proximity to human habitation was affecting the health of our people and our environment. So we launched a campaign, Ken Sarawiwa, the late environmental Ken Sarawiwa, established what we call the Movement for the Survival of Ogoni People. And established that campaign and sensitized the people to say, hey, if you are not doing this 1, 2, 3 for us, stop taking our oil. And that happened in 1990. By 1993, January 4th, the people came together to say, Shell, stop taking oil. And we stopped Shell from taking oil. And the Ogoni leaders were framed up in a murder charge, set up a military tribunal that sentenced them to death in 1995, and they were executed by hanging on November 10, 1995 by General Sani Abacha, a military despot, to teach other ethnic nationalities a lesson that if you want to try the federal government, we will kill you. But the Ogoni people, after the death of our leaders, we have continued the struggle. I'm one of the leaders. You can imagine how young I am to be a leader of our people, because they kill all our elders. And we have continued to hold on the struggle that you can't take our oil unless you begin to do the right things in our land. It was not quite long ago that United Nations Environment Program, UNEP, came to do an environmental audit in our land. They submitted the report on August 4, 2011. It was mind-blowing that there is benzene, a cancer-causing carcinogen, in the water we take in Ogoni, that there is hydrocarbon in the air we breathe and in the river, and that the water we drink in Ogoni is 900 times worse than level recommended by World Health Organization and 1,000 times worse than level we should drink in Nigeria. That the soil, our land, is dead by 5 meters, two-story building down is dead, and that most of the people in Ogoni have lived all their life there. Life has become so short and all that. That was the report and the recommendation. And as I speak to you, the government of Nigeria and Shell, they are yet to commence the implementation of that report that recommended immediate cleanup, that it should set up $1 billion to commence the cleanup. They have not done that. It was the new president now. Buhari was sworn in May this year, May 29. He's just beginning to take steps now to set up a governance structure that we commence the cleanup. We are waiting before everybody will die in my land that the cleanup should commence. There are issues of political marginalization where since Ogoni came into existence, no Ogoni man has been governor, no Ogoni has been deputy governor, no Ogoni has been speaker. In the local environment where we live, we've been marginalized in our state. I'm not talking about the nation as a whole. Yet, we are a distinct ethnic nationality with our culture, with our language, different, and we are subjected as slaves to study other people's languages in school and not our own. So our languages is dying, our culture is dying, and we don't want that. So we continue as a distinct ethnic nationality to see what we can do. What I have here is our flag. It's a flag of our, that was designed by our leaders as a flag of our people. As our identity, as, and we have a distinct identity in our place, and we want to maintain that and pass that on to our children until we achieve everything that our people live and fought for. Well, definitely, all the goals are almost connected. We have that has to do with climate change and the environment, which has adversely affected my people very seriously, because it is the environmental issue that has completely destroyed the livelihoods of the Ogoni people, being fishermen and farmers. It is our environmental issue and campaign that also led to the murder and hanging of Ken Sarawewa, who was an environmentalist who committed no offense, than that government should take a better care of the environment. So that's very important to us. But again, inequality, the issue of inequality is a global disease and pain. You see very few, 1%, insignificant 1% of the total global population becoming too rich every year, while the other 99% are becoming poorer, to the extent where you have categories of nations as advanced nations, developing nations. I mean, it shouldn't be. So the issue of inequality is a problem to me. There are some nations and instances where it further affects gender, that the women and the men, there are things women cannot do, women cannot drive, women cannot do this. Women are almost consigned to slaves. It shouldn't be, because we are equal, there should be equal rights. So the issue of inequality is something that really, even if what has affected my people very seriously is the environmental issue, but the issue of inequality is worse. It's worse because it is painful to see you work so hard only to make money for its insignificant few. How like the issue of land grab in my ethnic nationality, where the government will just come in the name of PPP to take farmlands from over 30,000 local farmers and give to one farmer. It takes one person taking farmland from 33,000 people that also have extended families. So what would they do? The only hope they have, the only inheritance from their forefathers, is the land. And one morning, government just come and take it away because of an unequal relationship. So I think that is evil. That is evil. And every time they come here, they pretend, they shout that they are going to do something serious to address this issue, but they are not. They are deceiving us. So I think it is time, I feel that it is time that those in the same categories, those that are cheated, those that are oppressed, those that are marginalized, those that are grouped into that category, we are more than the 1%. It is high time, I think, that we come together to fight this evil. Because as long as we keep quiet, it will continue and consume all of us. So I think that we are fortunate to be here when this adoption is taking place. I think that the civil society has a job to do to mobilize the ordinary people, to build a mass movement of people so that they know that they have been cheated. They know where the pains are. And as a group, we make demands, non-violent demands, on the insignificant 1% number, and we may not be able to get 100%, but we can have an improvement. We can improve on what you know, we suffered in the MDGs. If we move with them, we don't need to fold hands, sit down, and said, "Is there? Let them do it," because the government is abdicating their roles in promoting social services. They are no more talking about it anymore. In fact, what they are just doing now is to give waiver to the 1%, giving them more money, taking from us. In fact, the only role and the only benefit that citizens got from government, government are removing their hands and making the citizens to further pay from their blood. So the civil society need to begin to conscientize, mobilize, sensitize the people. Everybody must know to their fingertips that their lives, their future, their destiny is tied to implementation of this. We must bridge the gap. We will not just be talking now. We need to walk the talk.